first time this morning. Oh, yes, please. We still have, this month, as you all know, we will have our elected officials that will be presenting the majority of this month. So this morning, we have.
Thank you, Steve. We have our two ladies from Raleigh. We have our Senator Joyce Waddell. And Representative Beverly Earle. So without any further ado, since we know them and we have no one that's here for the first time, we will just start. We will open up with Joyce, since she was here first. And wait, and there may be some others that may come in a little later, and we will ask them to join them.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
And thank you all for being here. This is a great opportunity for us to share some of the things that are going on in Raleigh, in the North Carolina Senate, where I serve, and also to look at what's coming up, the things that we will be focusing on and participating in as we move forward. I'm Joyce Waddell, and I serve Senate District 40. I've completed my first term in office thanks to you and the confidence that you placed in me sending me to Raleigh. I begin with my second term, and I do have an opponent. I had a primary, and I have someone who's opposing me in the general election, and that's kind of unusual for someone to have both opponents in the primary and the general election, but I have them both. So some of the things that I focused on this past year in the General Assembly, our short session, is tuition, not raising tuition for college students. And that was a bill that I sponsored, and that bill did pass, was put in the budget. So it did pass. And our budget book
looks
something like this, so you gotta thumb through a whole lot of stuff before you get to all of the things that are contained therein. So we were able to make some accomplishments. As you know, in the Senate, there are 50 senators, and of the 50 senators, the Democrats make up 16 of them. So it's very difficult for us to get things passed unless you're working with your colleagues across the aisle. But we work together as a delegation, and I always enjoy hearing from you. Anytime we have bills that are on the floor, bills that have been filed, or bills that are coming up, I make certain that I contact persons back here at home and see what your thoughts are on them and see how you would want us to vote. And I'll tell you, it varies so much sometimes. You start getting 100 emails going one way, 2 days later you're getting 100 going the opposite way. So you really have to evaluate everything, look at the consequences, and look at the people that you're serving and the difference that it's going to make, and vote accordingly. We worked on tuition credits, also worked on doing a long session, domestic violence in the face of a minor, and I was able to get that bill passed. And the strange thing that happened with that one, it was put in with an abortion bill, and sometimes bills don't stand alone. You may file it one way, and next time you see it, it's in with two or three other bills. So I ended up having to vote against it, but it did pass. So we've made a lot of accomplishments. And you asked me to start off with just to tell you something. As we move forward, we'll talk about some other accomplishments and the things that we're going to be working on as we move forward.
Good morning. I'm Beverly Earle, and I am currently serving my 11th term in the North Carolina House. I have certainly enjoyed my time in the legislature, really enjoyed it until the last couple, 4 years. but Joyce has said a lot about what we do. It's really, the Democrats have not had very much in the way of leadership in the last 4 years. So we're kind of, we're there trying to put out fires. And I also want to say that coming up in January, hopefully things will be different in the House. If we pick up 4 seats, then we'll be able, when Cooper is elected governor, we will be able to sustain his veto, whereas that will be some checks and balance, some bit of control, and Democrats will be relevant, certainly, in the House. And so we're looking forward to picking up seats. Some of the things that we discussed in the short session, we dealt with the coal ash legislation. Of course, you know, HB2 has been on our radar for the last since March. And we dealt with the the police camera legislation. One of the pieces that we dealt with that just came up recently in a meeting that I was attending a part of was the protest petition. And I don't know how much you might know about that, but it took away the citizens' right to protest rezoning. And of course, most of the Democrats voted against it, but needless to say, it passed. And I also have a list of all the new taxes that the Republicans put in on services. Many of the services that you used to not have to pay taxes on. When you get your car repaired, you always had to pay tax on the parts, but you didn't have to pay tax on the service. It was a charge, but there was no tax attached to it. Well, that has changed. And I'll give my other two colleagues who just came in late to I'll give them an opportunity to introduce themselves.
Well, as I said, better late than never, we're here. And we thank you for that intro. I am Representative Becky Carney, and I represent District 102. This used to be in my district before the gerrymandering took place. It has been an interesting history to watch since the Democrats lost the majority. And I think we all have seen that from many different aspects. I am running for re-election. I have no opposition, but I'm here today because I think it is up to all of us to go wherever we can during any time of year, whether it's an election or not. And one thing that Beverly hit a lot of things we talked about in the short session, but I think with one of the big issues to me that has really made a mark on the state is the unemployment insurance and the hard burden that is placed on a lot of working families when two people in the family are working, or one is working, they lose their job, especially when their children are involved. So we have seen a huge drop in those that are even applying or rather looking for jobs. I think that's an issue that we need to go back and readdress. And there's a group that's looking to do that. After the long session convenes, that's along with education, is at the top and foremost. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning. I am Representative Cunningham. I represent District 106. I'm completing my second term, going into my third term. I have no opposition. And it's just a couple of things that we have not been able to do that still is on the forefront of lots of people throughout the entire state, and that's the Medicaid expansion. We have not been able to do that. That will probably be coming up again this coming session in an alternative way to look at how we can assist those 300,000 people in getting some type of healthcare services. The other thing that we're probably going to be seeing is raise the age. Representative Earle and I went to the Commission on Criminal Justice Reform, and they're looking at raising the age from 16 to 18 for juveniles. And that would help a lot, but we do need $20 million in the budget for that. So that's a couple of issues. And we're also going to be looking at additional Department of Health and Human Services issues that are going to be coming up, because we still have so many people that need healthcare services in the community. And Representative Carney is correct. The unemployment benefits continue to affect people throughout the state, because it went from 20-something weeks to 12 weeks. It dropped down from 500 and something to your max of $350 or something like that. And the thing about that is, if you're doing it, if you're working a very well-paying job, then you only can get that max of $300 and something. And many people can't survive on that based on housing needs and other needs that they need, such as essential needs like paying bills. Thank you.
Okay, at this time, we will entertain any questions. Our first question comes from Sarah.
Okay, good morning, ladies, and thank you so much for being here. Jackie Walton always has been responsible for contacting the legislators, and I don't know if you said, Becky, you said you can't. Is it okay if I just have a little conversation with Becky?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. you said somebody, you're not in this district in any sense. Which one of you said that? Okay. So, and you didn't get a notice from Jackie. And you, all right, Carla.
No.
Okay, so could that, Carla, are you out of our district also? I mean, So I don't know why you didn't get something, because you know you're supposed to come here. Okay. Big pardon.
We don't have opposition, so we figured that.
Maybe that is the reason. Jackie does. But we'd like to see you. We need to hear from you. And I think, Madam Presider, if they would just explain, because, talk about how outnumbered you are, the Democrats are in the Senate, if you're up there, why you have such a hard time. Okay, thank you, Madam Presider.
Up in the Senate, it's worse than it is in the House, because 50 senators and we have only 16 Democrats, so we are highly outnumbered. And it's not unusual for us to be in discussions and they say, you people on the back row. So they make sure that they put all of the Democrats, we're seated on the back row, we have two rows. Republicans, they're seated on the front row. And any time that they want to say something, if they don't agree with you, they say, you people on the back row. This is what the back row thinks, because that's where we are seated. And as you move up in seniority, then your seat rotates. You have the opportunity to rotate it toward the center, but you're on the back row. So it's very difficult. We don't have enough people to sustain a veto, or to even break a super majority. with 16, but we do the very best that we can. And surprisingly, we can get some of our Republican colleagues on many issues to stand and vote with us. One of the toughest things that we had to work on was this issue about HBCUs, historically black colleges and universities, the funds that they wanted to give to those universities, cut tuition to make tuition $500 a year. And they ended up with so much opposition. We dealt with this for a long time. So much opposition from alumni, from friends of the universities, that they had to back off. Apodaca backed off. And he included the opportunity scholarships for them, the Cheatham White scholarships, which would be for AAT and UNC and University of North Carolina in Durham. So they were able to get scholarships, but that's still going to be something that will be ongoing. As you think about it, when they move forward with something like that, the next year, next biennium, because we're working on a two-year budget framework, it may change.
Well, our numbers, we're quickly doing the math because it changes. There are 120 members in the House, and currently there are 77 Republicans, 42 Democrats, and one independent. He was a former Democrat that switched over to independent, and he caucuses with the Republican caucus. Similar to the comments that Joyce was making, it does make it hard when you're in the majority, but I think our delegation has worked together on several issues where we've made a difference. I know Representative Earle has had a couple of bills that got passed, and it's because she worked very hard to get the issue, the policy issue before us, and not because of the party issues. I think it is, I think that is, and I came in, and I apologize for being late, but I came in and I think Representative Earle was commenting about, and I just lost my train of thought. It was, anyway, she was, the conversation that has taken place in Raleigh, I'll come back to that. Yeah. It'll come back to me. You were talking about the taking back some seats in the House, and that's a very real possibility, and that does, as she said, give us veto proof in the majority. It's difficult to work across the aisle when there are already so many preconceived notions about each party. But if we have, Democrats have made, even in the minority, we made an impact on the budget this year. There were several issues that the Republicans were divided on, and they relied on Democrats to come to the table. Because we were in that position, we were able to lobby hard for some issues that we wanted in there, like defending the state employees on their COLA. We were able to get the House to stick firm and on the increase, which was not enough, but they were even cutting it further in the Senate. So it's challenging, but it's also working to a small degree, but we had to change that.
I wanted to make a comment concerning our numbers. We have, on any given piece of legislation, we have probably three or four or maybe five Democrats that vote with the Republicans oftentimes. And sometimes, probably, if they would hold with the Democrats, then we may be more effective, but we have sometimes up to five
Democrats that will vote with the Republicans on substantial legislation, on things that I'm thinking that our community would benefit by a Democratic vote. Thank you. In the House, it is quite challenging because really I consider myself to be pretty progressive on a lot of issues. And like when HB 2 came up, I was definitely not in support of HB 2. I want to see the entire bill disappear. And the sections in the bill seem to have been focused on section 1, which was the bathroom, which was not a major issue with me. But when you went down to section 2 and section 3 said the city and the county could not do minimum wage increases on budgets. So that impacts my district significantly when I have a high unemployment rate in my area. So the focus should have been on the entire bill. And they characterized it that way in the media so that the media would follow and bump it up inside our communities just to focus on the bathroom when it should have been the entire bill. So you're dealing with ideology and philosophy. I've been up there two terms and I put a suicide prevention bill in, which is, we are one of the highest in the state for that particular, in the country for that particular issue. Twice the national average for veterans committing suicide. It passed unanimously in the House, two times went to the Senate. The Senate won't touch a steady bill. So even between the chambers, we have dichotomy going on. So within the House caucus, we do lose several members on the other side, and I believe it was about 10 that supported HB 2, Democrats. So, and they look at their constituents, whatever their constituents are guiding them to do. And that's basically what most of us do, is look at what our constituents want us to do. It's not about us voting the way that we think we ought to vote, it's voting the way your constituents are expressing themselves they want you to vote.
I want to say also that we will be facing the redistricting, and that's going to be coming up, which will be making a difference in our numbers. And as we look at what will probably happen, as we look at what the state will do with redistricting, of course, you know, the judge said we will hold right now because we were so close to this election. But when we get back in Raleigh, we'll be faced with that again. What the Senate is looking at, what we're fearful of, is that we may even lose some seats. We're trying very hard to maintain what we have, but some of our counties in eastern North Carolina are very, very vulnerable when it comes to that redistricting. So that's something that we'll be watching and working with closely with. Of course, in the House, you will probably gain some seats. It's more difficult in the Senate because we cover a much larger range of constituencies. We're looking at 160 voters in each of our Senate districts, and some of in each of the districts. Yes. Mm-hmm. 160,000. That's right. 160,000 in our districts. And in eastern North Carolina, it's spread a lot. Sometimes they have as many as 5 counties that they cover. So that's something that will make a difference as we move forward when we talk about our numbers.
Okay, Ben.
Yes, you spoke earlier about one of the issues that's near and dear to my heart, and that's in raising the age when it comes to the people treated as juveniles in for criminal matters. I think, Ms. Carney, I think you said something to the effect it being hung up because of the cost of $20 million. Could you explain to me what's associated, the cost associated with that raise?
The cost that will be associated with is looking at moving that particular population from the jail placement. They would have to be separated. They already separated now, but if you go to 18, you're gonna have to have changes within the court system itself. Going to have changes with the district judges and what they can do as far as sentencing. So you're going to see sentencing changes involved as well. Because most people know by science that children's brains are not totally developed at 16. So that's why it's been such a big push to change that law, to change it to 18, because of that particular thing in medical research showing up.
One of the other issues that's going to cost money is that there's going to be counseling for those youth that get into to trouble, so as for them not to go, have to go into the system later on. So there's going to be all kinds of programs in place to keep these kids kind of straight and keep them out of trouble. And I don't know what the programs will be because they did not. This was Carl and I attended. It was a judicial panel that is looking, they were going around the state and they were speaking to judges and other folk on recommendations of what should be done to the judicial system. And this was one that we had a lot of representatives from here in Mecklenburg County to speak on this particular issue of raising the age from 16 to 18. But that's kind of where the money is coming from. There's a lot of different agencies that deal with these children, and they've got they've got plans in place already that some of them are able to implement with contributions and all. But part of that money is going to go for programs to keep these kids kind of focused.
I just want to quickly add there have been numerous bills. I'm in my seventh term in the House. There have been numerous bills that Democrats have put forward over those years to raise the age. And last term, we had a Republican come on and run it as a primary, Representative Avila in Wake County, and still couldn't get the support for it. But I'm reminded, and I remind you, about sometimes good things worth having are worth waiting to a point. Representative Martha Alexander, when I went to Raleigh, she had been working on mental health parity insurance. It took her 11 years to keep coming back to the legislature, and she finally got that. So I think with the public more and more educated on this and all the dynamics of why it's imperative we do that, I think that issue is now at the forefront, especially with the courts, which is a good thing. I've always said, and I'll continue to say, public will drives public policy, and I think that's what we're going to be seeing very soon.
Good morning, Pam.
Good morning.
On August 17th, 1984, I was a little 22-year-old foreign student coming, landing on JFK International Airport in New York City. And I have a 30-year-old son born in Charlotte, North Carolina. And when I came in here, Charles Wakala was a 40-year-old child playing in the Roseland. So I use that to say I have a little seasoning in this society, even though I wasn't born here, I have a little seasoning. So my question is this. Since 1984, there has been a few times, as I remember, there were more Democrats in Raleigh than Republicans. But not one time, within that time, within those times when there were more Democrats than Republicans, I go.
Just ask your question.
All right.
why there are more Republicans than Democrats.
No, when they were Republican, why they never complained, why they never blamed the Democrats for not doing it.
Well,
I never heard that. Maybe I heard it, but I never heard them complaining the same way when the Republican, the Democrat complained. I never heard that.
I think he's saying when the Republicans were, when the Republicans were the minority, they weren't complaining as much about what the majority was doing of Democrats. They probably were.
Well, is this our time? They were, believe me, they were planning because they came in an election year a few years back and swept. So when we were in the majority and they were in the minority, they did take us on. They blasted us. They complained about everything we did, from budgeting, from spending too much money on education during my tenure. Representative Earle has been there longer than I have, and I'm sure she will share some of those same feelings. But it's a two-way street. And now that they're in the majority, we have been questioning what they're doing extensively, because the damage, the proof of the damage is there within our state and within our citizens.
Okay, Beverly, you want to ask the question?
I was trying to make sure I understood the question.
I don't want you to go back to him. Not right now. Come on up here. You need to come up and sit with me. Okay, go ahead, Beth.
Why they were not complaining when we were being charged? They did complain when we were being charged, and I'm going to apologize for complaining now. Based on some of the things, North Carolina was perceived as to be a very progressive state. They have taken this state back 20 years, and it will take another 20 years to correct some of this. Medicaid reform, there's all kinds of issues. The reason that we are complaining, because it impacts my constituents and the people that I'm there to represent. So that's the reason I'm complaining, and I would hope that many of you in this room would be complaining. But they complained, and they complained loud. That's one of the reasons that we actually lost, is because they complained every little thing we did. And their chair of the Republican Party for the state, and I hate to be graphic, but you know what? They whipped our ass up and down Jones Street like they owned us, and nobody said anything. That's how they got, and they don't have a problem with telling a lie and moving on, because most of the time nobody challenges them. So I don't want to say any more, because I don't want to get any more upset.
What I'd like to say about this in the Senate, the chamber that I serve in, of us, the 16 of us, none of them in charge. We don't have anybody as a vice chair or chairman of any committee. And they are the ones that assign their chairs and vice chairs, and they haven't done that. Prior to my coming, it was different. And when the Democrats were in charge, they were more inclusive about involving them and having them serve as chairs and vice chairs and working up more along with them. They don't have any of us. And so we serve really working hard to make our voices heard. Yes. And what I didn't tell you is we started, Becky is the chairman of our delegation.
Good.
And she gets us together periodically and keeps us together so that we represent some of the things that are important to you. In this community, we come there representing this community, and she leads us.
And while whoever's getting ready to say something, you know, what has happened is mostly our fault. Because see, we need to be together. I keep telling you all that. Don't you know that? You know we are supposed to be together. Those of us who are Democrats, we need to stick with the fuck, because there aren't a lot of Republicans who look out for poor people. Absolutely. I had planned to ask Carla a question, but I don't have enough time.
Ahead. You go ahead and ask.
Well, I know you've been working on this health care thing as long. You took that up after Martha left there. And so keep on doing, keep on pushing. And Becky said something about sometimes it's okay to wait. You know, some of us can't wait too much longer, but just keep on pushing. And thank you all. Thank you so much. And thank you, Lord, for letting me.
Okay.
Did you want to
respond?
Well, I did.
You go ahead.
Oh, okay. I was going to respond to about the complainant. My colleagues are exactly right. Everybody complains. Nobody's ever totally satisfied with what happens in Raleigh. But when you're dealing with the ideology and the philosophy that the opposite side has, it is very, very challenging. But I want you to know, after redistricting, and that's one thing we need to be putting on our mind again, that that's going to come up again after this election cycle. And that's how we ended up losing the chambers. It's because of redistricting. They were in charge during redistricting. They drew the lines to benefit themselves. And if we don't have Democrats in charge by the time that next census is done, we'll be in the same shape for another 10 years. And that's something that we really need to be thinking about. If we really want change, then we need to be getting out voting before it's time for the census to be done. Because they had a plan. When they realized they could not take the presidential race, they made a decision to go after governorships and legislatures. And they were successful.
Good morning. Larkin Engelson, thank y'all for being here. Y'all were talking about how the two bodies are split, Democrat and Republican. And I know in the House we being the Democrats, need to move at least four seats to sustain our next governor, Cooper's veto. And that there are at least that many, probably a couple more seats in the state that are competitive. In the Senate, how many races do y'all look at as being competitive seats where a Democrat could unseat an incumbent Republican this year?
We're looking at that very closely now. We're hoping that we can pick up at least four seats, but in the Senate, it takes a lot of money. You're talking about over $100,000 when it comes to picking up a seat in the Senate. So it's most likely that you can do your best results and get your best results in the House. And we're just too far from that. We need about 9 seats.
And I will just add real quickly to what Senator Joyce Waddell just said, and that is, it's going to take time in the Senate. There are only 16 Democrats, and there are 50 Senate seats, and they pretty much locked up the vast majority through gerrymandering. So it's going to take time, but the Senate has an aggressive plan. I think Joyce has referred to that, on how to incrementally start chipping away at getting back that majority.
Senator Waddell talked about the amount of money it takes to pick up Senate seats. In some of our seats, it takes $150,000 to $300,000 to pick up our seats as well on our side in very competitive areas. And right now, you can imagine that they got stockpiles of money in their little accounts because they were in charge. And when you're in charge, more money flows in to that particular side. So we do have some seats that could go $300,000 to get picked up.
And I'd like to say, one of the weakest senators from down east, when they tried to challenge him for his seat, they put over $500,000 behind that Senator Cook in that district for him to keep that seat. $500,000. So that's what it's going to take.
What would you all speak to a millennial generation that doesn't recognize or even subscribe to either party? Is there some type of idea, do you have any mechanisms in place to educate or try to incline them to embrace the split party system? You understand my question? I'm speaking to millennials and the fact that they don't necessarily subscribe to a Democrat or Republican platform. Are there any things that we can do to try to engender them to understand or even change, because we're talking about how progressive we are, to make them embrace, you know, our political process?
And, well, I'd just like to
don't know if I can answer it, but, you know, I have offered to make myself available to speak to that particular population, because I think it's important that everybody, including the Marines, know what's in their best interest. And if they make another decision, that's up to them. But, you know, I have had the opportunity to speak to a lot of people, and I guess I'm not getting the same, and you know, you're more connected with that group and you're part of them, but, you know, I'm not getting the same sense that they are so much opposed, or they don't know where they're going or which way to go. I think a lot of them supported Bernie Sanders, and I think some of them were misled, and you know, but because he is not the nominee, I hope that they understand that the person that will best represent their interests is still the Democratic Party. And you hear that the Democrats are taking advantage of African Americans. Well, that is not true. This is our party. And if we don't speak up and be a part of this party and make our issues known, then, you know, we share some of that blame. But I, this past weekend, I was talking to some students from UNC Charlotte, and they were quite clear on where they were going and what they, which party they thought represented them best. So, and but you know, I'm not trying to say that they don't, but I think that it's up to us, everybody in here, not just elected officials, because there's so few of us, but it's up to everybody in here to impress upon young people how important it is. I have threatened my two granddaughters within an inch of their life. Right. If they don't register and don't vote the right way, I will break their fingers, every one of them. So that, you know, that is a threat that is real. But I think it's up to us to make sure that everybody understands how important it is to vote for Democrats.
Right.
Thank you for the question.
Yes.
I have been engaged with the Millennials for quite a while, and right now, their population is fastest, and we have more of them right now in North Carolina than any other group, so I want to acknowledge that. But on the way here, I heard on the radio they were talking about the presidential election, and this young man was driving this guy in the cab, and he asked him, who was he voting for president? And he said, well, I'm not voting. And he said, why? He said, well, Obama's not on the ticket. So millennials usually vote during the presidential election.
Yes.
But we have a growth of independence because the demographics inside of Mecklenburg County, inside of the larger urban area, is changing so rapidly. Right now we have probably a third independence. So I would say to the millennials that you need to get engaged in every election. But you also need to vote your issue, vote what you believe in. I am a Democrat. Right now in Mecklenburg County, I don't see an independent winning because we're so divided up. And I have to be honest about that, because in the future, I see it coming, because the independents are growing in leaps and bounds in this area. So we need to stay focused on the issues and continue to engage the millennials, because they are thinking differently from the generation before them. And I might not be a millennial, but I'm not too far away that I can hear them and understand where they're coming from because of dealing with that population on long term, because I have, you know, young adults, and they're not millennials. As children, I have young adults.
Well, I thank you for the question too, because as Carla said, this is a changing dynamic within demographics in the state, and certainly as she said here in Charlotte. I have 6 children, grandchildren. I have 12 grandchildren, 2 of which are 18. And this is a topic that when we're together, rarely as a full group, but when we're together with some, they talk about. But what they have come to recognize is, and especially I have two in their 30s, they are coming to grips with the fact that community service and involvement is a whole lot more important to them than having that big mansion. So their goals are set to make a difference within the community they live in, rather than trying to chase the dollar to expand their horizon. So what I say to, and I have a few that have reached out, and what I say to them is, you have to, as several have said, there are issues that are important to them, the environment first and foremost, because they are looking ahead farther than most elected officials are. We have very, very few visionary leaders at the state level, the national level, and indeed at our local level. So I think that's what the millennials are saying now. They're waking up to the fact that got to get an education, got to get out of college with all this debt, got to get a job to pay off the debt. But I think what's happening is they're waking up and seeing, as we grow as a country, as a state, it is up to them to step up and their voices be heard. So what I say to them is, look at the issues that are burning with you. If it's the environment, if it's infrastructure, if it's living conditions for where your residents will be, very transient community. They are not age group. They are not buying houses. They're not buying condos. So I tell them, pick that burning issue and educate yourself on it from the standpoint of the parties, and mainly from the standpoint of who's on the ballot. Look at those two candidates and take your issue as your benchmark. Do they support the environment or are they opposed to the environment? I'll just use that as an example. Educating is important, and it's up to the elected officials to be more cognizant of that changing dynamics in our demographics and changing the conversation. It is going to happen. And I go back over and over and over to Democrats, and I am a Democrat, to push and educate people on why it is important to vote. If you don't vote, that's a no vote, in my opinion.
What I'd like to say about that is, in our offices, in my office, I strongly encourage pages. In fact, I go to the high schools and send to the high schools in the district, but to send pages to Raleigh.
Yes.
They provide them with an opportunity to see just how the General Assembly works. And many of them are really surprised. It gives them an opportunity to meet other young people throughout the state. Gives them an opportunity to see each chamber. So that's very important. I think we need to encourage that page program, because that gives young people great opportunities. And in each of our offices, we have interns, basically students who are in law school, students who are in college, who come and intern. Great opportunities for them to see and to get involved in what goes on in Raleigh, and really to spread the word. Even though they are growing in numbers when it comes to eligibility to vote, we still have our seniors. And those seniors tend to be consistent. They vote, and they vote every time. So we want to get to the place where we can have millennials doing the same thing. Consistent voting, not only in the presidential election, but every time. What I often hear from them, and I do go to colleges and speak with them in high schools a lot to talk with them, they're interested in radio station WIIFM. What's in it for me? And that's what they're tuned to. And when you can tell them college tuition, look at what we're trying to do there, with reduction in college tuition. Our bill that we introduced is to hold that tuition constant. Once you enter college at a certain number, if it was $1,000, and you stay for your 5 years, it does not increase for that particular individual. So we've been able to get some traction on that and to get that put in the budget. So as we move forward and let them know what's in it for them, we look at the early college programs that we've been able to get funding for. Not as much, but that's increasing. You can go finish your 2 years in college while you're in high school. That's a big change, and it's making leaps and bounds throughout the state.
Good morning. Good morning, I'm Kim Sue Montgomery. It's funny you talk about college. I was just recently talking to some students, and they just, some college students, and they said that college was overrated. But that's not my question. My question is this. I just recently raised funds for the Salvation Army because they said they ran out of beds. They have people there that's working 40-hour work weeks, and they can't afford rent. They can't afford to buy a home. And if you take a look around Charlotte, you see all the cranes and all the development. And my question is the topic of affordable housing being discussed? That's a huge issue. Could you please address that? Thank you.
Do I have a response for that?
Well, we're sitting here to discuss most of those issues dealing with housing, and it is a huge issue. That's a city council and a county commission discussion and policies that they look at. But we are at the state level through the housing authority. We do look at and fund to report housing finance, excuse me, housing authority is local, but the housing finance of how we are distributing monies towards those areas. We get notices periodically of some entities within our area, our region, that have gotten money from the state. It is an issue. It is impacting the livelihood of people, and being able to have a place to sleep at night, to me, absolutely is critical for you being able to get up and go out and work. So it's a huge issue. Poverty is a huge issue. And we've got a wonderful group that it has come together through Chairman Trevor Fuller that has put together this group of business people, task force, local people that are tackling that issue. It's a huge issue. North Carolina is up there in the top numbers for the number of people living in poverty, but children important. So that is an issue that, as far as zoning and the funding through the housing authorities, city council.
Thank you for bringing it up, because Representative Carney touched on the poverty issue, and in Mecklenburg County, we are last in the country for upward mobility. That means a child born in poverty is less likely to get out of poverty. So that's why they formed the task force. The task force study that they're looking at is 30 years old. So if you look at minimum wage increase, which we put several bills in to raise the minimum wage, until the minimum wage raised to a livable wage inside of Mecklenburg County, we're going to continue to have housing problems because we don't have affordable housing. So if you work in two or three jobs, you can imagine the social ills within the dynamics of that family unit. So if she worked in three jobs, she might be single, which most parents right now are single. Over 54% of parents in the state are single. They're raising their children alone. They work in two or three jobs, then how you expect your child to go to school and learn, because you're not there, you're working. So until we can look at the entire component of the social ills that are attacking our community that continues to perpetrate poverty, then we're going to continue to have issues of housing, healthcare services, food on the table, and education issues for our young children.
Beverly,
you mentioned something earlier, and thank you, regarding there's going to be an opportunity or funds available to have programs to help children. I have spoken of this before, and that is to make sure that all groups from all walks of life have an opportunity to obtain those funds. And I'm talking about even the grassroots, because a lot of times there's a lot of red tape, and small organizations like people in this room who do a lot to help people cannot apply or don't have the resources to obtain those funds. There's so much red tape. I hope you understand what I'm saying. That I always wanted to know, would there be some way to establish like agency to assist them in trying to obtain the funds or to apply for the funds, so that they too could serve individuals, because they do a great job, but they don't always have the support system to apply, and they can be accountable, but they don't always have the support system to apply and get the funds. So I want to make sure that we consider what can we do to make sure that they too have an opportunity to be provided these funds.
Thank you. When I spoke of funds available, it was in relationship to the raising the aid.
Excuse me? Okay,
you're after.
Can you hear her? Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
It was connected to the raising the age from 16 to 18. That has not even passed. That was the amount of money that was associated that would it would take, or that they are looking to appropriate if and ever the age gets raised from 16 to 18. That was the pot of money that I was speaking about, the $20 million. That they are saying it would take to implement or to be effective when they raise that age.
So there's not going to be programs for children.
That's what we're talking about. There will be programs to work, but I mean we're possibly talking about years. First of all, the legislation has to be passed, and you know, it was coming through the courts, but. All of that has to come to the legislature to be passed, and the money has to be appropriated once the bill is passed. So, thank you.
I said I was going to ask a question, but I lied. Why don't North Carolina take this? Certain parts of the world where they're trying to alleviate poverty, period. You go to Europe, the rest of Europe, we don't have poverty as we know it. So why don't North Carolina take a leadership position in eliminating poverty instead of supporting programs for poverty? You know, poverty has become a big business. If you want to get out of poverty, stop you a nonprofit, World War IV.
One of the things that we're doing in the legislature is we're working toward a increasing the minimum wage. And when you give people jobs, you provide opportunities, we're looking to increase that to a living wage so that you have enough money to put food on the table. You don't have to work two and three jobs to make it happen. And still you want to have that great tax base to cover the programs and services that are necessary. Looking at educating people, giving them a good education so that they can get a good job. And with that, reducing, making tuition available and making it affordable. And so those are some of the things that help people to get out of poverty. Let's start with educating them. Early childhood education, providing the things that are needed and necessary so that when kids are born, from the cradle to when they get into school, we provide an opportunity. So we start early. And then they're able to get great jobs, have their families contribute to the economy, and make life better for everybody.
I'm just going to make a short response to that. There are two things, and my colleagues have said, and we've all said over and over, raising the minimum wage to a living wage. But there's something that I'm not sure if a lot of you know, but the current majority eliminated the earned income tax credit. And that is where it hits people below the belt. They aren't getting those tax breaks like the wealthier 1 or 2% are getting. So that's the issue that I think we have to address when we go back in, that will have an impact incrementally over time to help with the poverty in this state. Reinstating the earned income tax credit. I just think y'all ought to get more educated and start lobbying. We're going to need all the help we can get.
And I just want to back up about the minimum wage, because we put in on the House side, I believe it was Representative Earle, five bills in all addressing a minimum wage increase, and none of them went to committee. So that's where the meat really hits the road, when they won't look at a minimum wage increase. Because in those rural areas, we think we're hurting, their people are hurting too, but that is not the priority. Because if it was, a minimum wage bill would have been heard in that chamber.
I just want to throw out, that's why we're making so much noise and complaining, just because of issues like this. And you need to take a look at the leadership and the kind of legislation that's coming out or that's not coming out.
And I can see that's important to a lot of us. And what I would encourage us to do is to have press conferences here. Don't wait until we get to Raleigh to let us hear from you. Let's have press conferences here in Charlotte, and focus on those things that are important, and start here, right here in this community. Then you'll be heard by not only the Democrats, Republicans, and everybody throughout this state. Not only the tax credit, we also look at the small business tax credit that's necessary, as well as the earned income tax credit and the child care tax credit. Those are things that we have to focus on to make a difference.
I'd like to say too that we all have newsletters on the website, and if you want to sign up, just contact us, and probably everybody, the whole delegation does, but I know the four of us have a newsletter that goes out, you know, every week or every week, so that kind of keeps you involved in what's going on.
Good morning. My name is Dimple Ajmera, and someone had asked a question about affordable housing. First, I want to thank you all for passing the North Carolina Housing Finance Agency approved 4 affordable projects right here in Charlotte. So thank you so much for doing that. I'm a strong advocate for workforce and affordable housing here in Charlotte. I serve on the Housing Authority Board. My question is, we are having a lot of folks. We have almost 34,000 folks in our waiting list for affordable housing today. And one of the issues we are dealing with is we have folks that are given Section 8 vouchers. However, they are not able to find a landlord who would take that voucher, because North Carolina allows income source-based discrimination. So what has been done to allow this income source-based discrimination so that we can house more folks that are in really dire need of affordable housing?
I would like to first take a stab at that. I did not realize that discrimination exists. I've got some rental houses, and I feel good when to take Section 8, because I know my money is coming every month, whereas with others it may not. So I mean, I had no idea that kind of had never heard that before, that there were hope that maybe in some neighborhoods, I don't know if that would be a factor. But what I've always said, as far as the housing authority is concerned, is, just like they expect certain behavior and certain, expect your place to be in certain repair, I think the housing authority needs to do a better job of making sure their tenants are ready for home rental. You know what I'm saying? And I think that may have something to do with it. And I'm just throwing that out because, I don't have a screen door now, but when I had a screen door, I had to have a screen door for 15 years. And then in a rental place, I might have to change screen doors every 2 years.
It's a hard regulation.
So that's all I'm just throwing out. I did not know that
it's
really
hard,
exists.
Yeah.
Are you also aware of a bill that was in the General Assembly allowing city councils to take over housing authorities? Were you aware of that bill?
No.
Okay. That does exist. And so if there are difficulties with managing, and when it came out of committee, of course I was totally opposed to it because I felt that you're doing a good job and you can manage. And when it came to the Senate floor, of course I spoke to it and voted against it. And call your persons who are responsible to let them know that they need to get in touch with everybody in the delegation and let them know this is not what you wanted. I was able to get a statement, but everything started coming very, very slow. As you know, when they start putting them on the calendar, it runs fast. You gotta be able to respond to us within, almost 24 hours. And you did mention about discrimination. There shouldn't be any discrimination in housing. That's against the law. That's why we have.
That's right.
That's why we have this Human Relations Council here. They have a section right here to deal with that. There shouldn't be. Shouldn't be that.
It's the income source discrimination. So landlord can say you are on Section 8 or you are on Social Security.
We have quite a few questions. Bacala, in 30 seconds, and if you all can respond in a minute, please. We're going to ask for some additional time.
I'm just going to quickly say this. It hasn't been until the last 6 weeks that I even heard about this issue. I've had two emails, or phone calls rather, from people that were impacted with that very issue. And I didn't know that like other members had not been aware that that was actually happening. And so I've sent it over to our staff, our legal staff, to give me some sort of background. And when I get that, I will try to share it with other members of our delegation. But I was appalled that that's happening. So thank you for bringing it up.
Hi, I'm Maylin Pratt. And so many of the issues we've been dealing with boil down to the unequal representation we have because of our voting districts. So the districts now are drawn by the majority party. The Democrats did it when they were in charge, now the Republicans are doing it. So my question is, would any of you support a bipartisan redistricting commission? And if so, or if not, whatever, do you think there's any reasonable chance we'll ever see that?
I'm going to speak for myself, but I think we all up here have been on record. There have been several bills introduced for an independent redistricting commission. And there were some Republicans in the last go-round that signed on. There was an effort with, I'm drawing a blank, but two bipartisan leaders, and they went through Duke University at their public policy school, and there are some real high-profile people that are that have been involved with that. They came out with a report recently that they absolutely see the advantage of a bipartisan independent effort, so, or task force, or commission, excuse me. So how long will it take for that to happen? I think we're finally gonna see some movement a little bit. I'm not sure if it will come into effect with this next redistricting round, because the bill that was before us most recently in last term was that it would be appointed and they would not have be in place for like 4 to 6 years. So it is it's incrementally, as I've said, over time, if public will drives public policy, people are crying out stronger that there be some change.
Well, I'd like to just offer, I do support having an independent committee to do it, but I guess you have to think about how independent is independent, because they're going to be appointed by Democrats and Republicans. So, you know, you just have to wonder, you know, we still could end up, it'll be something different, which we need, but you have to wonder and just how independent it will be. Thank you.
One last question and comment on that issue. There was an effort to, in the debate on that bill that was introduced, that staff be the ones to draw those districts, and that fell, you know, flat on its face.
Good morning, and thank you so much. Each of these sessions, I learned something. You answered the question concerning the bipartisan committee that I wanted to ask, but since I have the microphone, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank each of you for your newsletters. I feel quite learned after receiving them. Please continue to do that. And the bipartisan committee, I am definitely for that.
Good morning, Lulu Duale. Thank you so much for being here today. I know we're short on time, but could you briefly discuss House Bill 972? It is the bill where law enforcement recordings are no longer to be made public record. Just last night, we saw another murder, police killing in Tulsa. I'm interested in knowing, you know, why so many Democrats would support this bill when it seems to be in direct conflict with the constituency they represent. Thank you.
Well, I believe the issue was brought up by a Democrat. I think Representative Moore is one of the people that worked on it. Well, with us being in the minority, we knew that it wasn't going to gain traction. So some of the other people in the chamber, I think Representative Faircloth and a couple of his other colleagues, took on the body cam bill. And of course, Representative Faircloth is with the Sheriff's Association. I don't know if you know how strong the North Carolina Sheriff's Association is, but they're a very powerful lobby group in North Carolina, and Representative Faircloth works with them very closely because he's an ex-sheriff. So when the bill was done, and Representative Moore did a bill, they probably dissected it, picked it apart, and said, well, this will work with this group of people, and this will work with that group of people. Now, I couldn't support the bill, and I'm gonna tell you why. Because it removed all transparency. So now, if something happens, we have a CRV review board. They no longer have that assess. If the county or the city or somebody asks for it, the police chief can say no. And if he says no, you gotta go to Superior Court to demand and go through the court system to get it. So that was why I could not support it.
Well, I voted for it, and I thought that we needed to have something in place, and if we had not
I guess, kind of gone along with something, we would not have had anything in place. And I take, until I see different, I take that our law enforcement at their word that they will reveal the cameras. And the next option would be to go before a judge to get it released. So, but I did vote for it because I thought we needed to have something in place to, and I think that, you know, if in fact we need to go back, we can go back and make some changes, but I really think that we need to have something in place.
And I'm gonna, I too voted for it. And Representative Cunningham said that it was Representative Rodney Moore that introduced that bill. He has done that twice, and he finally got a Republican to come on board to co-sponsor with him. I'm not going to speak to that for him. I don't know if he's already been or if he's coming next week, but I think that's something that you could ask him. Sometimes as legislators, we follow, especially in the delegation, we try to get educated by the delegation member or the bill sponsor. And I mean, I absolutely recognize that it's important for us to have these body cameras in place. I support that. And the dash cam cameras. Like Beverly, Representative Earle said, if we don't get something on the books, it may not be all that we want, but if it's on the books, it's easier to come back and add to it. It is harder, well, former representative, former Senator Graham, and the Senate may be different, but I think that, with like Beverly Earle, I supported that because it was a start. Is there is a huge discussion that's going on. It's going on among the legislators. And part of that bill is that we will come back in next session and address how it's working, what the implementation has been. And we were told on the floor, but we know how that goes sometimes, that the changes would be addressed in the next session if they were not working.
Okay. We have some of our regulars that want to have second questions, and we'd like to get to them because we know that they're here because they really have some good questions. But we'd like to ask them, 30 seconds, please, and the answers, 1 minute or less, please. But Ken will ask his 30-second question. Thank you, Ken.
I'm often amused when I see legislators, especially those from the Democratic side of the aisle, talking about issues that confront us, but yet they only became issues that confront us when you lost the majority. So my question to you is, has the black representation at the state level ever sat down to come up with an agenda that specifically targets the things that you may particularly want for your constituency? Did you do that before the majority switched? And why is it that we're now talking about minimum wage when we didn't talk about it when the Democrats were in control?
Oh, yes, we did.
Okay. 1 minute.
Oh, let me quickly say that since you brought up minimum wage, that is absolutely not true. Representative Alma Adams introduced that bill for the longest time, and I think at one point, somewhere down the road, it may have gotten moved to 10, 15 cents when it went, but she introduced that over and over again. There are many other things that the Democrats did when they were in leadership. We did not take this state backwards as Republicans are doing at this particular time. So there are things that we did do that represent and that support our constituents, but we have moved backwards in the state under the Republican leadership.
I do want to point out one thing, that Representative Earle is right. We have in my 14 years, both under both leaderships, majority, minority. We did have those bills introduced. And I'll give you an example of when the Democrats, when we weren't in charge, of what happened. Tom Tillis, I know, but Tom Tillis was running for state senator. And he was asked at a debate, do you think that the minimum wage should be increased? Now remember, he was the speaker for two terms. He would not allow those bills to even be heard in committee. And yet when his answer, what his answer was that it should be a state issue and not a federal issue. So he flipped when he was running for election. We have had bipartisan sponsorship throughout the years. That has been one of the first things, and I hope when I was running, we've got to change it. So we have support.
My name is Lori, and you just answered my question, sweetheart. There, why the people that we pick, they flip-flop, and then you don't know what, this year they voted no, next year they vote yes for this stuff, and so you have to really go in and do a study of who is voting how and who is picking what, and it's really confusing, like this H Bill 2. A lot of my friends say, well, what is the repeal stuff? What is that stuff all about? Then they say, they'll say something else the next time. So we need to get it together so that people will know what's going on. Absolutely no.
Hello, everyone. I'm Constance Johnson with City Political. My questions are number one.
Hey, hurry!
Stop, gonna grab you after me. Okay. One question.
Yes.
How will this legislation, these bills regarding gerrymandering and redistricting, affect you personally and affect your districts personally? And do you have any inroads to what is taking place in regards to redistricting in your own personal Mecklenburg County?
Well, first of all, we do not know what it's going to look like. And in the last round of redistricting, there were no Democrats in the room. They appointed a redistricting committee. But when the leadership met and drew those lines, our Democrats that had been appointed to that, which I was not one, I don't think any of us up here were, they were not in the room when those were drawn. So there is no answer of what they will look like.
Representative Carney is exactly right. And usually when they decide who's going to be on that team to do redistricting, it's the leadership. So the minority is not sending somebody in the room. It's the leadership who's picking who to go in the room and make that decision. And even if they are on the committee, usually it's a separate meeting going on.
Well, I can tell you already, they are looking ahead, they're looking forward. The Republicans already have maps. They have maps in place, several of them. So they're working ahead of time, and we really don't, we're not at the table right now. So we don't know what they are, but we're trying to be proactive also. And stay ahead, just like they are, with maps and looking at what's involved, looking at population changes. So we're working behind the scenes, but believe me, since they're in charge, they already have it.
Good morning. My name is Nikisha Glover, and the saying goes, we borrow the syrup from our children. In light of the colonial pipeline spill out in Alabama, which has affected us in North Carolina with gas shortages and the like that's going to come, I want to know what you all are doing to support environmental protections. It's outright illegal in North Carolina to purchase your energy from a third-party energy provider, and I know that some of you have the ability to make that change. So in regards to that, offshore drilling is allowed in our state, fracking is allowed in our state, so I want to hear how we are addressing environmental protections in our state.
One of the things that happened at the, and I'll try to be a minute. One of the things that happened in the legislature last term, this term in the budget, we ended those tax solar tax credits. They let them sunset. We did, and the majority did. There's been an outright movement to not expand solar energy in the state, although we were the fastest growing state with solar energy here. We've now dropped to second after they did not extend the tax credit deadline. We have major issues with how our Environmental Protection Agency has changed under the majority leadership. We've cut back in many areas within staff. So those issues are the ones that we were fighting, we were voting against and voting for the extension of the solar tax credit. So that is an alternative energy source. The windmills.
On the environmental issues, and I know that we have seen the ad that was ran with an epidemiologist. She decided she would resign because people were told that the drinking water was safe to drink again. So looking forward to what we need to be looking at for environmental protection is change of governor, because they're the ones that get to appoint that person that sits at the top of that board on that commission. So when we start looking at the environmental issues with the Department of Energy and Resources, those people are appointed, and you need to look and see certain commissions get paid, and those are appointed by the governor. And so if you look at that, you can kind of see a money trail of what's really happening with how stuff is getting passed and why it's getting passed. You need to dig deep, but it's there.
Thank you. We have Basista and then Tommy, and Sarah will end this discussion this morning. But we'd like to also make sure that we get out. I missed you. You had a question.
I just have a quick question. I would just like to know, where can we find a list of the taxes, services? Is there a place where we can go and just find the new taxes that they're putting on services? Now, where can we find that list?
I've got a list of them, and if you could give me your email address, I will
Okay, I'm sorry about that. But anyway, we're going to have the questions from the two of them, and Sarah's going to end with a statement. And we need your announcements, and we'd like for you to give them to Steve if you have them in writing. But you can make it, we will be able to make announcements. We have about 15 more minutes. Thank you, Mr.
Once more, great presentation to the entire panel. If some kind of a magical whim happened that the African American begin overwhelmingly voting for the Republican Party. So, do you believe or do you not believe that the Republican Party will adjust to cater to the black agenda?
No.
My question is, like every question you ask about, it come back down to minimum wages. Why don't we tax everyone equally? Why don't we tax the rich? Why don't we attack the rich, tax everybody at a straight tax rate instead of just minimum wage up and minimum wage down? That don't eliminate poverty.
Okay, y'all
want to
ask somebody?
Look, that's a new bill that we'll have to introduce, and with just taxing the rich.
No, straight tax.
You asked me if you're here with a flat tax.
One tax, straight tax.
I'll make a response quickly. Yeah. A flat tax has absolutely does not get traction in the legislature. I served on a commission about 8 years ago, and we were looking at modernizing our tax system, and that was Democrats in charge, and you couldn't get anywhere, but the flat tax came up, and that's just always slammed right down when it's brought up. I can't remember, was it Ross Perot that ran for president on a flat tax issue? And it doesn't go anywhere.
Okay, I think it's back to me now. Ladies, I want to thank you so much for coming. We really, really appreciate you so very much.
I have a real important announcement I need to make.
Okay, go ahead, Carla.
Okay, thank you. I wanted to make everyone aware that there's a community roundtable here today, and it's on criminal justice issues. It's at 2 o'clock to 4:15 at the Goodwill Industries on Wilkerson Boulevard.
That's right.
And it's the Mothers of the Movement. And the Mothers of the Movement are the mothers of the murdered children by the police officers. And they're going to be here today having that round table. And I'm asking all of you to call the address.
Goodwill.
It's the new Goodwill Industry of the Southern Piedmont out near the airport on Wilkerson Boulevard. Thank you.
Thank you, Carla, for making that announcement. And I would like to thank all of you for your cooperation today. I think it has gone so well. Now, know that it can't go like this all the time. We're going to let it go like this when we have the elected folk. Please continue to be cooperative. Ask your questions. Try not to do so much commentary before, and listen to them, because this is why they are here, you know, to talk to us, and we're to listen and ask them questions. So thank you again. Thank all of you so very much. Okay, announcements, and I think I probably need to make the first one, because it is so very important.